Five probability distributions. In this first section, we're going to study probability distributions. The section introduces the concept of a random variable and the concept of a probability distribution. We illustrate how a probability distribution is a graph that visually depicts a probability distribution. We show how to find the important parameters of mean, standard deviation, and variance for a probability distribution, and most importantly, we describe how to determine whether outcomes are significant, significantly low, or significantly high. A random variable is a variable typically represented by X that has a single numerical value determined by chance for each outcome of a procedure. A probability distribution is a description that gives the probability for each value of the random variable. It's often expressed in the form of a table, graph, or formula. A discrete random variable has a collection of values that is finite or countable. If there are infinitely many values, the number of values is countable if it is possible to count them individually, such as the number of tosses of a coin before getting heads. A continuous random variable has infinitely many values and the collection of values is not countable. That is, it's not possible to count the individual items because at least some of them are on a continuous scale, such as body temperature. Every probability distribution must satisfy each of the following three requirements. There is a numerical, not categorical, random variable X, and its number values are associated with corresponding probabilities. The summation of all the probabilities of X is equal to 1, where X assumes all possible values. The sum of the probabilities must be 1, but just keep in mind that some sums such as 0.999 or 1.001 are acceptable because the individual probabilities were probably rounded in the table. The probability of a random variable X must be a number between 0 and 1 inclusive for every individual X value of the random variable X. And then the coin toss example. So we've got an example. Let's consider tossing two coins with the following random variable. X is the number of heads when two coins are tossed. The above X is a random variable because its numerical values depend on chance. It is numerical, 0, 1, 2, and there are the probabilities in the table. With two coins tossed, the number of heads can be 0, 1, or 2, and the table is a probability distribution because it gives the probability of each value of the random variable X, and it satisfies the three requirements that we listed earlier. The variable X is a numerical random variable, and its values are associated with probabilities. The summation of those probabilities, 0.25 plus 0.50 plus 0.25, is 1. And then each of those probabilities is a number between 0 and 1 inclusive. The random variable X in the table is discrete because it has three possible values, 0, 1, and 2, and 3 is a finite number. So it satisfies the requirement of being finite, and of course they are countable. A graph of a probability distribution is called a probability histogram. It's similar to a relative frequency histogram, but the vertical scale shows probabilities instead of relative frequencies based on actual sample results. We will see in chapter 6 and later chapters there is a correspondence between areas in the bars and probabilities. Probability formula. A probability distribution could also be in the form of a formula. Consider this formula for our coin toss example. P of X, X is the number of heads that you would get by tossing two coins, is equal to 1 divided by this product, 2 times the quantity 2 minus X factorial and X factorial, where X can be 0, 1, or 2. We find that P of 0 is 0.25. When we use the formula, P of 1 is 0.50, P of 2 is 0.25. We'll use this formula in chapter 6, so don't stress right now over not being able to plug the numbers in. If you're not familiar with factorial, that will come later. The probabilities found using this formula are the same as those in the table. Here's an example. Job interview mistakes. Hiring managers were asked to identify the biggest mistakes that job applicants make during an interview, and the table below is based on their responses. Does the table below describe a probability distribution? Remember, we have to meet the three requirements: that the random variable X is numerical and finite and countable, that every probability of each X is a number between 0 and 1 inclusive, and the sum of the probabilities is 1. If we look for those requirements for this particular display, we find that the value of X is not numerical in nature, therefore it violates that first requirement. Those are categorical data points instead of numbers. The table also violates the second requirement. The sum is 1.57 and not 1. Because the three requirements are not all satisfied, then we conclude it is not a probability distribution. Parameters of a probability distribution. Remember that with a probability distribution, we have a description of a population instead of a sample. So the values of the mean, standard deviation, and variance are parameters, not statistics. The mean, variance, and standard deviation of a discrete probability distribution can be found with the following formulas. The mean is the sum of each X times its probability. The variance, sigma squared, for a probability distribution is given by this formula. There is another formula, but this is the one that's in your formulas and charts table. It's actually the standard deviation that's in there, but you'll notice that to find the standard deviation, sigma, you simply take the square root of the variance. So mean mu, variance sigma squared, and standard deviation sigma, these population parameters are found using these formulas. Expected value of a discrete random variable X is denoted by capital E, and it is the mean value of the outcomes. So capital E is equal to mu, and E can be found by using that formula for the population mean for the distribution, which is the summation of each X times its probability. Let's look at an example. The table below describes the probability distribution for the number of heads when two coins are tossed. Find the mean, variance, and standard deviation for the probability distribution described. We've already identified that this is a probability distribution, that it satisfies the three requirements. And in order to calculate the mean, we list our x's, we list each of those p of x's from the previous table. To find the mean, you multiply these values together, add them up, and this is going to give you the mean. For the standard deviation, we're going to take our formula. Sigma is equal to the square root of the summation of x squared times p of x. So we're going to find that, and then we're going to subtract mu squared. Be careful with mu. Make sure that you use an unrounded version of mu when you plug it into the formula. So if I do the same type of calculation that you see in this table and just extend these out, 0 squared times 0.25, 1 squared times 0.5, 2 squared times 0.25, when I find those values and add them together, I will get the number that I put into the formula here. So let me go ahead and do that real quick. So this would be 0 and then 0.5. So this is 0, this is 0.5, this one is 2 squared, or 4, times 0.25, which is 1. When I add those together, I get 1.5. That's the summation of x squared times p of x. And sigma is equal to the square root of 1.5 minus the mean, which was 1.00 squared. Sigma is equal to the square root of 0.5. Okay, now what was I asked to find? I was asked to find the mean, the variance, and the standard deviation. So before I take square root, that's actually the variance. So sigma squared equals 0.5. When I take the square root of 0.5, I end up with the standard deviation. So the mean was 1.00, sigma squared is 0.5. Sigma is the square root of 0.5, or 0.70711. We round this to one significant, or to the one more place in the original x values. So my sigma, or standard deviation, is 0.7. Standard deviation is the square root of the variance, and that just solidifies the previous slide's values. Interpretation. When tossing two coins, the mean number of heads is 1, the variance is 0.5 heads squared, which doesn't make a lot of sense, heads squared, and the standard deviation is 0.7 heads, which is why we use the standard deviation instead of the variance when we're dealing with an interpretation. In this particular case. Also, the expected value for the number of heads, remember that's the same thing as the mean, when two coins tossed is 1, which is the same value as the mean. If we were to collect data on a large number of trials with two coins tossed in each trial, we would expect to get a mean of 1 heads. Identifying probability distributions. In these exercises, determine whether a probability distribution is given. If it is given, find the mean and standard deviation. If it is not given, identify the requirements that are not satisfied. Pickup line. Ted is not particularly creative. He uses the pickup line. If I could rearrange the alphabet, I'd put you and I together. The random variable X is the number of women Ted approaches before encountering one who reacts positively. In the table, we have the description of the probability distribution, or the display showing that. X is a definitely numerical and finite and countable. P of X, the probability of each of the occurrence of the variable X, is these are all numbers between 0 and 1 inclusive, so there's two of the three satisfied criteria. However, the third one is not satisfied because when you add these P of X's together, you do not get 1. So you do not have all of the probabilities that are possible in this scenario. Therefore, this is not a probability distribution, and the probabilities do indicate that Ted needs some work. Problem 2 is self-driving vehicle. Groups of adults are randomly selected and arranged in groups of 3. The random variable X is the number in the group who say they feel comfortable in a self-driving vehicle. X is numerical in nature, it's finite and countable, all the P of X's are probabilities between 0 and 1 inclusive, and if you add together those probabilities, you will find that the probability total in the table is 1. Let's do that real quick with a basic calculator. 0.358 plus 0.439 plus 0.179 plus 0.024 certainly sums to 1. So for this particular problem, we're going to find the mean and the standard deviation. Now, I've already written the formulas at the top of our workspace for the mean and standard deviation, and I'm going to recreate the table to then calculate those values. X is 0, 1, 2, 3. For the mean, I want to find X times its corresponding probability. I'm going to take each X in the table and I'm going to multiply it by its corresponding probability, and I'll just show that I'm going to do that. 2 times 0.179, I guess I could be consistent in how I'm showing this, 0.024. Each one of those values, the product, that's going to be 0, this is going to be 0.439, 2 times 0.179, is 0.358, and then 3 times 0.024, 3 times 0.024 gives me the last number, 0.072. When I add those together, that is the summation, 0.439 plus 0.358 plus 0.072. So the summation is 0.869, which means mu is approximately 0.9. We round to one more place than our original x is. X is a whole number, so we would go to the tenths place. So there is my mean. The standard deviation, I'm going to extend the table, and I'm going to find the x squared times p of x. This is the formula that's on your formulas and charts packet page. So the one that I'm going to use, there are two of them in the book, but this is the one we're going to use. So I'm going to take each one of the x's. That first one is 0, so 0 squared times its p of x, which is 0.358. I'm going to take 1 squared times the 0.439 for its probability value, 2 squared times 0.179, and then 3 squared times 0.024. Find each one of those values, add them up for the summation, and then plug those into the formula. So this is 0, this is 0.439. 2 squared times 0.179 is 4 times 0.179, which is 0.716. This next one is 3 squared, so 9 times 0.024 gives me 0.216. When I add those together, 0.439, 0.716, 0.216, I get 1.371. So that's the summation. The standard deviation is found by taking that summation, 1.371, subtracting the mean, 0.869 squared. I don't use the rounded version because that may lead me to an imaginary number. And I'm just doing the calculation now. So I end up with sigma is equal to 0.78, or rounding to one more place than my original x, the standard deviation is 0.8. Significant results are found by using the range rule of thumb. So significantly low values are the mean minus 2 times the standard deviation or lower. Significantly high values are the mean plus 2 times the standard deviation or higher. And values that are not considered significant are between those minimum and maximum values that define the boundaries. So here's a picture to represent what that says. Example, identifying significant results with the range rule of thumb. We found that when tossing two coins, the mean is 1 head and the standard deviation is 0.7. Use those results and the range rule of thumb to determine whether 2 heads is a significantly high number of heads. So if I use the range rule of thumb and I find the value that separates significantly non-significant numbers from significantly high, the outcome of 2 heads is significantly high if it's greater than or equal to the mean plus 2 times the standard deviation. Well, the mean is 1. Standard deviation is 0.7. This is from a previous example that we did. We get the mean plus 2 standard deviations is 2.4 heads. Significantly high numbers of heads are 2.4 and above. Therefore, based on these results, we conclude that 2 heads is not a significantly high number of heads because 2 is not greater than or equal to 2.4. Significantly high number of successes. X successes among N trials is a significantly high number of successes if the probability of X or more successes is 0.05 or less. That is, X is a significantly high number of successes if P of the probability of X or more is less than 0.05. So what we did back here was we used the range rule of thumb to determine if the number of heads was a significantly high number of heads or significantly low number of heads using the count of heads. What we're doing here is we're using the probability of ending up in this case with a heads when you toss a coin or two coins. And if that probability is less than 0.05, then it is not significantly high or low. The value point of 0.05 is not absolutely rigid. Sometimes we do use 0.01, sometimes we use 0.10. These could be used to distinguish results that are significant versus those that are not. So keep that in mind, especially when we do hypothesis testing in Chapter 8. The rare event rule for inferential statistics. If under a given assumption, the probability of a particular outcome is very small and the outcome occurs significantly less or significantly greater than what we expect with that assumption, we conclude the assumption is probably not correct. So that's just a rare event rule that you may want to keep in mind. So last but not least, we're going to do a problem where we're going to determine if the outcome is significant based on probabilities. So here we have a table, a probability distribution. It says in the exercise below, refer to the accompanying table which describes the number of adults in groups of five who reported sleepwalking. And this gives the reference for the data. X is numerical in nature. It is countable and finite, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And we have probabilities that are between 0 and 1 inclusive. If we were to add these together, it should sum to 1, if not just a little teeny bit lower or more or less due to maybe some rounding. So we're dealing with a probability distribution. We are tasked with several things to do. So the first thing is to find the probability of getting exactly 4 sleepwalkers among 5 adults. So exactly 4 sleepwalkers would be this number. So this probability of exactly 4 would be 0.027. The probability of getting 4 or more would be 4 or 5, right? 4 or more. So I would need to add the probabilities for 4 and 5 together to give me 0.029. Which probability is relevant for determining whether 4 is a significantly high number of sleepwalkers among 5 adults? The results from Part A or Part B? Well, remember what you have as the definition for significantly high numbers. Let's see, significantly high number of successes if the probability of X or more successes. So it would stand to reason that Part B would be the most logical number to use in this particular case to determine significantly high numbers of sleepwalkers. Now again, we're doing probability. So the last question is, for a significantly high number of sleepwalkers among 5 adults, why or why not? Well, the probability of 4 or more was equal to 0.029. And is the question then, you should ask yourself, is this less than or equal to 0.05? And it's less than 0.05, so that would be yes, because the probability of 4 or more sleepwalkers is 0.029, which is very low compared to the probability of 0.05, which is the standard that we use. So that concludes the lecture portion of this section. Please proceed and to do the homework.